Hello people, welcome to Gurukula. I'm Jai. So today in this video, we are going to see about a particular modulation format, that is QPSK, that is quadrature phase shift keying. So in the previous video, we might have seen what are all the modulation requirements or what are all the requirements for selecting a particular modulation format. And then we have seen in detail about binary phase shift keying. And then we also found that the binary phase shift keying is not so spectrum efficient, and also this is not suitable for high data rate transmissions. So that we will see another type of modulation format today, that is quadrature phase shift keying, which is far better than the binary phase shift keying. So today in this video, we can see about the quadrature phase shift keying, the power spectral density, the bandwidth occupancy, and the transmitter and receiver structure of quadrature phase shift keying. So today we will get into this particular topic. So quadrature phase shift keying, why should we go for quadrature phase shift keying? Because we have certain drawbacks in the earlier method, that is binary phase shift keying. So the well-known drawbacks of binary phase shift keyings are, it will carry only one bit in a symbol, and also that is not suitable for high data rates. So because of these two drawbacks, and also it is not spectrum efficient as well. So because of all these drawbacks, we will go for another modulation scheme, that is what we call it as quadrature phase shift keying. So quadrature phase shift keying has twice the bandwidth efficiency of BPSK. So since, how is this achieved? Because here in this quadrature phase shift keying, we are sending two bits in a transmitted single modulation symbol. So here we will be having totally four equally spaced values. So that is differentiated in space. So this is 0, and this is pi by 2, and this is pi, and this is 3 pi by 2. So these are all the equally spaced signals whatever we have, and each and every symbol will carry two bits of information. So say for an example, if this carries 00 and this will carry 01, this will carry 11 and this will carry 10. So these many information, so since it carries two bits of information in one particular symbol, then this is far better than the binary phase shift keying. So eventually, when you look at the constellation diagram itself, it is clear that it has four waveforms to be represented. So all these four waveforms are equally spaced other than the phase shift. So the frequency and then the amplitude part remains the same. So the equation for the QPSK is given by, so root of 2 ES divided by TS cos of 2 pi FCT plus I minus 1 times pi by 2. So it is important to note that when we are discussing BPSK, when we are discussing BPSK and the amplitude were written in terms of EB and then TB. So that is, it is in terms of bits, whereas each and every symbol is going to carry one bit. So there is no point of differentiating bits and then symbol, because one bit is equals to one symbol in case of BPSK. And whereas in case of QPSK is concerned, we are discussing in terms of ES and then TB. Whereas ES is nothing but we are representing in terms of symbols, whereas in one symbol there will be two bits. So that is the relationship between EB and then TB, and the equation will take the form ES and then TS. So since we have to generate four waveforms, then we will take I values is equals to 1, 2, 3 and 4. So by expanding this equation by using trigonometric identity cos of A plus B, we will be getting this particular equation. So root of some amplitude part, cos term, so cos of A times cos of B minus sine of A and sine of B. So this expression, we can always take that phi 1 of t, which is equals to root of 2 divided by ts cos of 2 pi fct. This is what I am taking as phi 1 of t. And then, so sine component, I am taking that as phi 2 of t. So this phi 1 of t and phi 2 of t is what we call it as basis function. So what is actually basis function? So we will see what basis function is. So basis function is nothing but they are set of sine and cosine waves with unity amplitude. So when there is a set of sine and cosine waves with unity amplitude, then we can call that as a basis function, generally in signals perspective. So here we have sine and sine component and then the cosine component with unity amplitude. So thus is what we call it as basis function. So we can rewrite the values of phi 1 of t and phi 2 of t in this particular equation so that we will end up with S QPSK is equals to, so this component multiplied with phi 1 of t and sine component multiplied with phi 2 of t, and where I takes the values of 1, 2, 3 and 4. And so now this equation is what we call it as basis signal, since this is generated from the basis function. So that is all about the equation part of the quadrature phase shift keying. So when we try to draw the power spectral density of QPSK, we have the QPSK power spectral density can be given in this particular form. There are two equations given. So deriving power spectral density is as similar to the power spectral density of binary phase shift keying. And the base equations are already given in the video of binary phase shift keying, where you can refer the binary phase shift keying videos over there. So this is a final equation which we will end up when we derive power spectral density for QPSK. So E of S divided by 2. So this equation, I will take it as first equation. And the first equation is represented in terms of symbol, as you could see that ES is represented over here. And the second equation is the same equation, but here the second equation is represented in terms of bits. So if we want to represent the power spectral density of QPSK in terms of bits, then the second equation will be the right form. So from this we can actually say what is the relation between EB and ES. So EB is equals to ES divided by 2, which is nothing but it can be observed in two different phases, where I can say that two bits are in one symbol. So two bits are placed in one symbol, or in other words I can say that as, or in other words I can say one symbol carries two bits at a time. So this is a relationship of this power spectral density. So when we try to plot this power spectral density, we will get the signal like this. So we will get the waveform like this, as we all know that this will be the main lobe and all these things will be the side lobes, and over here this will be the side lobe. So in order to calculate the bandwidth occupancy has to be calculated with null to null of the main lobe. So null to null main lobe is given over here. So this is of the period FC plus RB by 2. So this is FC plus RB by 2. And then this is FC minus RB by 2. That is FC minus RB by 2. So taking the difference between these two things, we will end up with RB. So we will now try to compare the bandwidth occupancy of the QPSK and then the PSD of binary phase shift keying, and we will see how QPSK is bandwidth efficient. So when you try to compare the constellation diagram of BPSK and then the QPSK, there are from the constellation diagram there are two important things which can be observed. So first one is the number of points on the constellation diagram. So the number of points on the constellation diagram can be represented as inversely proportional to the spectrum occupancy. That is, more the number of points, lesser the bandwidth occupancy. So it is always advantageous to have higher amount of points on the constellation diagram. So when we look at the constellation diagram of BPSK, so this is the constellation diagram of BPSK, then you could see there are only 2 points over here, and then there are 4 points in case of QPSK is concerned. So this is of QPSK. So considering the number of points, and then it is inversely proportional to the spectrum occupancy. So this has lesser number of points, so this will occupy more amount of bandwidth, and this has more number of points, so that this will occupy lesser amount of bandwidth on the signal. So that is actually proved by using the power spec, the bandwidth occupancy equation over here, whereas in BPSK it occupies 2 times RB. So RB is the bitrate, so 2 times RB, and whereas in case of QPSK we could see that it ends up in only RB, which is half the time better. So the power, and then the second inference is that the distance between the points. So what do we infer from the distance between the point? The distance between the point is directly proportional to the error probability equation. And unfortunately, in BPSK and as well as in QPSK, the distance between two points remains the same. So that is the reason why we end up with same error probability equation. Whereas in BPSK, so this is for BPSK and this is for QPSK is concerned. So we will get the same equations for BPSK and as well as the QPSK equation. So that is how, so by this comparison clearly states that QPSK is more spectrum efficient as compared to BPSK signals. So coming to the transmitter diagram of BPSK, so now the first step, so this is a block diagram representing the QPSK transmitter. The first step is all the binary signals which are generated has to be converted to non-zero values using unipolar to bipolar converter. So this step is somewhat more important. So the conversion of signals from unipolar to bipolar converter is very much important, because at the receiver side we will be making use of this. So when discussing receiver side, I will stress the importance of converting this unipolar to bipolar converter. But as of now, whenever the binary signals are to be, as a first and foremost stage, so this is the first step. So whereas in the first step, the binary signals are converted to non-return to zero values using unipolar to bipolar converters. Sorry, unipolar to bipolar converter to get M of T. So when we have obtained M of T, then we go for the second step. So M of T is separated as MI of T and MQ of T, where MI of T are nothing but the in-phase component, or sometimes it is called as even components. And the other part, that is MQ of T, that is what we call it as quadrature component, or sometimes it is called as odd component. So as a second stage, we will be using serial to parallel converter. So this will be converting the M of T into two streams. So this is my MI of T stream and this is my MQ of T stream, where MI of T is what we call it as even streams and MQ of T is what we call it as odd streams. So when it is divided into two streams, then we can go for the third step, whereas MI of T and MQ of T are modulated separately by using basis function phi 1 of T and phi 2 of T. So here I have the third step. In the third step, the in-phase components, that is MI of T, are modulated with phi 1 of T, and here MQ of T is modulated with phi 2 of T, where phi 1 of T and phi 2 of T are the basis functions which we have seen in the equations part. And phi 1 of T and phi 2 of T will have a sufficient phase difference among them. And then finally, as a fourth step, all these signals has to be summed up in order to get the QPSK signal. So this is how the QPSK signals will be transmitted at the transmitter side. So whereas at the receiver side, so we will have the received signal, and we have the first stage, we have a band pass filter. So this is to remove the out of band signal and also to avoid the adjacent channel interference. So that is the primary function of this BPF over here in this particular stage. And then since we have processed all the input signal into MI of T and MQ of T, even here it is required to convert the signals into two streams such as MI of T and then MQ of T. So after separating, one branch will be focusing on MI of T and the other branch will be focusing on MQ of T. So here we have a carrier recovery circuit where it will be generating the basis function phi 1 of T and then phi 2 of T with necessary phase shifts. So here you will be demodulating the signal, and then MI of T is decided separately, and then MQ of T is decided separately, and finally they will be multiplexed together over here in order to get the original binary sequence. So this is a simple receiver structure of the QPSK. However, there are certain drawbacks in the QPSK part as well. So what are all the drawbacks over here? So we all know that this is a constellation diagram of the QPSK, when we assume if there is a 2 bits change that is happening in the input sequence, assuming that 00 is converted to 11. So there is a 2 bit change. So if there is a 2 bit change, then the state has to be changed from here. The state of the QPSK has to be shifted from here to here. So if this shift has to happen, then for a particular instant of time, my system will cross the origin of the constellation diagram over here. So this will attract, for a particular instant of time, my system has to cross the zero point over here. So this will cause certain drawbacks, that is, this causes the non-linearity effects in the system. So because of this non-linearity effect, then the system will attract or it will regenerate the side lobes, whatever have been suppressed at the transmitter side. And also, the linear amplifiers that are used in the system cannot amplify the signals to the optimum levels. So these drawbacks will actually will be faced when we have the 2-bit change in the system. So when we have a 2-bit change, then the system has to cross over the zero through the zero point. So crossing over this origin of constellation diagram will essentially create the non-linearity effect. So due to the non-linearity effect, what will happen? All the side lobes, whatever we have suppressed at the transmitter side, will be regenerated back over here when the system crosses the zero crossing point. So that, and also one more drawback is the linear amplifiers, whatever that are used in the system, cannot amplify the signals to the optimum levels. So optimal amplification will not happen. So these are all the major drawbacks that we have in the quadrature phase shift keying. So these drawbacks of quadrature phase shift keying is eliminated in another form of QPSK. So that is what we call it as OQPSK. So OQPSK, that is what we call it as offset QPSK. So the concepts and the detailed transmitter and receiver diagram of OQPSK will be discussed in the next video. Until then, happy learning. Thank you.